Thank you for that. It was beautiful. Indeed, after that, it must be well with our souls. The beauty of the harmonies, but also the beauty of the message. Lord, in the few moments that I have, may your words be spoken, not mine. And indeed, may we leave not coming or leaving the same way as we came. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I believe that most of us here have heard sermons that you just can't forget for one reason or another. Hopefully, these sermons are remembered for the impact that they made on your lives. It may have been a life-changing experience, the sermon for which you heard. But this morning, I'm going to preach an old sermon. And in fact, not only is it an old one, it is one that I borrowed. And before you say, oh, Pastor, come on, before you condemn me of plagiarism, I'm only going to use just one verse anyway. I don't think that classes as plagiarism. But I'm going to focus on one verse which we've read for our scripture lesson. It was preached, of course, by the Dean of Preachers. The preacher you know well, the sermon you probably know well. You've read it on numerous occasions, no doubt. It's known, of course, as the Sermon on the Mount, preached by Jesus himself. And despite the fact that a large crowd had gathered on that mountainside, verse 2 of Matthew chapter 5 tells us that his principal audience was who? You have it? Matthew chapter 5, verse 2. Well, by those who gathered around close to Jesus, sitting close to him, next to him, were his who? Disciples. However, the spirit of prophecy tells us that among those listening to the words of Jesus were the poor peasants and fishermen who hoped to hear the assurance that their wretched hovels, the scanty food, the life of toil and fear of want were to be exchanged for mansions of plenty and days of ease. Spirit of prophecy tells us that. Desire of Ages, page 163, 164. But also, Desire of Ages tells us, and Mark chapter 2, verse 6, implies that there were those there with other intentions. The scribes and Pharisees were not always on Jesus' side. In fact, we're told that spies were sent to listen in on what was going on. As I said, they had ulterior motives which were not honorable. But you know something? Jesus, even though he may have known all this, he did not mind them listening. Why? Because he wanted to introduce and wanted them to understand that he was talking about a kingdom. A kingdom that the Pharisees and scribes thought would be a kingdom that would overthrow the Roman oppressors, bring freedom and joy on this earth. But no, he was talking about a kingdom, that there were privileges and responsibilities of being citizens of this kingdom, the kingdom of heaven. And so in chapter 5, he introduces this by saying that perfection of character, which is the goal of citizenship, was the first part of his sermon. Then in chapter 6, he wished to get to introduce incentives to right living and what exemplary citizenship is all about, chapter 6. And then in chapter 7, which I encourage you to read for yourselves, he identified what those privileges and responsibilities are, being a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. And so, as was his custom, he spoke using everyday, common, well-known, familiar items to his listeners so that they could identify with. And in verse 13, he uses the common commodity of what? Salt. Salt. Now, salt for us today is generally used to add taste for foods that would either be bland or tasteless. You know, for those of us from the Caribbean islands, what is our favorite fish? Saltfish. Of course, you got to stay away from that, you know, if you want your blood pressure to remain calm. It's not a good thing, but ackee and saltfish, maybe it's not a good time to be talking about food right now, but don't worry, I'm not going to be long, and it's coming. Might not be ackee and saltfish, but something just as nice and tasty. But you know, friends, back in Bible times, when Jesus was here on this earth, in that society, pure salt was often more valuable than gold. Give me gold any day. But no, back then, the salt was more valuable. When edible salt was challenging to find and to use, as a result, it was highly prized. In fact, the word we use to describe someone's wages comes from the Latin word salarium, which referred to the money paid to the Roman soldiers so they could purchase salt. It was referred to as salt money. But what made salt so valuable? Often we talk about somebody being worth their salt, which that meant, you know, they were highly regarded, highly valued. Now Jesus knew that those listening as he preached knew the value of salt. What does the Bible say to us about salt? Turn with me to Job chapter 6. Job chapter 6 and verse 6. Let's discover some of what salt had value, what it did in Bible times. In the Old Testament, Job chapter 6 and verse 6. Again, I read from the King James Version, whatever translation you have before you. But the book of Job says, chapter 6, verse 6, can that which is unsavory be eaten without what? Salt. Or is there any taste in the white of an egg? Now this could have been written today, couldn't it? For those of you who are lactose vegetarians, not strict vegetarians, may have had a boiled egg this morning, and I'm sure most of you would be a little salted just to give it a little taste. And so, what is Job telling us one of the main purposes of salt? Flavor. So it seasons, yeah? Well, that's valuable. Because there's nothing worse than eating food that is tasteless and bland. But what else does the Bible tell us about salt and its use? Let's stay in the Old Testament. Let's go to 2 Kings chapter 2. Go with me to 2 Kings chapter 2 And we're going to read verses 20 to 22. 2 Kings chapter 2 and verse 22. Or 20 to 22. Let's look here at, again, Saul's, how valid it was back in Bible times. 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 20 to 22. We read there, "And he said, bring me a new cruse and put what? Salt therein. And they brought it to him, and he went forth unto the spring of the waters, and what did he do with the salt? Cast the salt in there and said, thus saith the Lord, I have what? Healed these waters. There shall not be from thence any more death or barren land." So what we see there is that this salt was put in the water to do what? To heal the water. And it seems to me that what we are told there, that salt has a, if you like, a healing, a purifying effect. Amen?
Yes.
All right, let's go to Leviticus chapter 2, verse 13. Leviticus chapter 2. It's Leviticus chapter 2 and verse 13. What are we told there? Again, talking about the value of salt. Leviticus chapter 2, verse 13. And it says there, Leviticus 2:13, "And every oblation of the meat offering shalt thou season with salt. Neither shalt thou suffer the salt of the covenant of thy God to be lacking from thy meat offering. With all thine offerings thou shalt what? Offer salt." And further as we go to Mark, in the New Testament, Mark chapter 10, verse 49. Quickly go with me to Mark chapter 10 and verse 49. Mark chapter 10, verse 49. And it reads, "And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called, and they called the blind man, saying unto him, be of good comfort, that he calleth thee." Now, am I reading the right passage?
Yes.
Yeah. Right. I thought it was, but maybe that's not the passage that I... However, what we're looking at here, especially as was identified in Leviticus chapter 2, verse 13, is salt. It was added to the meat sacrifice. And unless the salt was added, it would appear that it was not acceptable as an offering. Am I right? And so here we see that the salt, as it penetrates in order to make a sacrifice acceptable. Salt seasons, salt heals, purifies, salt makes things acceptable. Now in the audience, who also were listening? There were the peasants and who? The other group? The fishermen. That's right. And as Jesus spoke, I can imagine the fishermen were nodding their heads, agreeing about what Jesus was talking about, salt. Because when he spoke, Jesus said about the salt of the earth, they knew well, these fishermen, the preserving power of salt. You see, salt prevented decay and restrained corruption. So, if salt seasons, if it heals, if it purifies and preserves, what makes it so valuable? Brethren, it's simple. Salt is valuable because of what It does. Are you with me? An important point. It is valuable because of what it does. So, if salt does not heal, or season, or heal, or purify, preserve, Jesus actually says in Matthew 5:13, which we read, he said it's good for what?
Nothing.
Nothing. Especially if it loses its saltiness. Now, church, we are the salt of the earth. You and I are valuable for what we do, for what you do. What do you mean, Pastor Sweet? Well, we have to ask the question. What does the Lord require of you and me? Well, I believe, as Jesus was speaking to his audience, as he's speaking to you and to me right now, he says that we are to go out and season communities and people living bland and flavorless lives. Do you know any folk like that? Folk who are seeking short-lived excitement with short-lived thrills, enjoying tasteless experiences. It's like out there, it's the bland leading the bland. Have mercy. Seems to me Jesus is saying that we must be different. Somebody ought to say amen. We must lead our communities to find flavor and zest in life. Amen. Colossians chapter 4, verse 6. Go with me to Colossians chapter 4 and verse 6. Colossians chapter 4, verse 6. We are told there, clear words, if we are to be salt in our communities, let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with what?
Salt.
That you may know that you ought to answer every man. And so, Colossians is telling us that we are to introduce our communities to the healing power of Jesus. The healing power, that healing power is physical healing, mental healing, relationship healing, spiritual healing. We should be keeping our, helping our communities to accept the saving grace of our Lord, helping them to become living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God, the salt that makes them acceptable. But be warned, Jesus tells us in verse 13 of chapter 5, salt can lose its saltiness. Now, when I said this to a chemist, they said, okay, what are you saying? Salt lose its saltiness? You see, the chemist would argue that sodium chloride is an extremely stable substance and cannot lose its flavor. All right, I'm not a chemist. However, what I do know is that back in Jesus' time, salt could become impure due to the primitive extraction methods of gathering salt from marshes along the seashores or from inland lakes. And as they gathered it, it would include impurities, many impurities. And secondly, during Jesus' time, there were those unscrupulous merchants who were known to, you know, mix other substances to make the salt go further and make more money. Good job we don't have people practicing that sort of thing today, do we? Well, we do know that salt, when it comes into contact with dampness or is exposed to rain, this highly insoluble salt itself is usually washed away, and it just leaves only an insipid white impurities. In fact, Desire of Ages, page 168, states, having said what I've just said, listen to what Ellen G. White says, but if Christians are such in name only, don't get upset with me, that's a spirit of prophecy, but if Christians are such in name only, they are like the salt that has lost its savour. They have no influence for good of the world through their misrepresentation of God. They are worse than unbelievers. Oh boy. So, in order that our lives may be a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, as Romans 12 tells us, they must be preserved and seasoned by the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ. Friends, if not, we become, as Jesus said, good for nothing. Trodden under the foot, as Jesus' listeners could identify with that, because they actually saw, as Jesus preached, the pathways white with salt that had been thrown away because of its worthlessness. And so, until we need now to go into our communities to help preserve them from the deadly decay and corruption of materialism, selfishness, moral degradation, with the gospel salt, if we don't, we become good for nothing. Again, I ask the question. The question is, what must we do to be of any use as the salt of the earth? That's easy. We must mingle. Remember the value of salt? What makes it so valuable? It's because what it does. You have got a salt pot maybe in your cupboard right now as I speak. Is that salt of any use if it stays in the cupboard, in the salt pot? No. The salt is only of any use and value when you take it out and you mingle it with food or whatever substance. And so, it seems to me, Jesus is saying, you and I, if we are the salt of the earth, it is important that we must mingle. Do not, Desire of Ages, page 168 tells us, do not withdraw yourselves from the world in order to escape persecution. You are to abide among men that savour of the divine love may be salt to preserve the world from corruption. This is heavy stuff, but not really that heavy. It's quite simple, really. Now, it seems to me that, again, Spirit of Prophecy highlights Enoch as who set as a good example, in that he says, Ellen White says, that he mingled with the ungodly, exhorting them to abhor the evil and choose the good. And as a faithful worker for God, he sought to save them. He warned the world, he preached faith in Christ, the Savior of the world, the sinner's only hope. You say, Pastor Sweeney, hang on a minute. That surely isn't good counsel. Because if I mix with the world, I might become like the world. True, but Spirit of Prophecy continues. Like him, a Enoch, we must walk with God. We must walk with God, bringing our will into submission to his will. We must train our minds to love purity and to think upon heavenly things. Then you and I can mingle safely with the world and be a witness to them instead of them being a witness to us. Jesus simply says, you are the salt of the earth. Is Harleston Road going to be a salt shaker left in the cupboard that really has no use, has none effect? Or are we going to be the salt that Jesus said is of value because of the mingling that salt should do to be effective? My prayer is this morning that you and I will truly be the salt of this earth and mingle and make a difference to this world before Jesus comes. Amen.
Amen. Amen.